Good evening, everyone. This is Kanishk Shekhar welcoming you all to the webinar, the session on post-independent consolidation, your GS Paper 1 UPSC exam. And today we will be discussing the India-Pakistan War of 1971. Now, before we proceed with the webinar, there are a few things I would like you to acquaint with. Bangladesh, this country was formed in 1971. What is today known as Bangladesh was earlier known as East Pakistan. So where we have Pakistan today, at that time it was known as West Pakistan, and Bangladesh at that time before 1971 was known as East Pakistan. So India was founded on both sides by Pakistan. Okay. On the one hand side there was West Pakistan, and Bangladesh as we know today was East Pakistan. So what was happening here, that East Pakistan, that is Bangladesh, as it was earlier called, it had a Bengali dominant population. The culture was predominantly Bengali. The language was Bengali, their cuisine was Bengali, their costumes, their festivals, everything had a Bengali hallmark on it. Now, on the contrary, West Pakistan had a predominantly Punjabi culture. Okay. So people from West Pakistan, they were not having very good opinion about their eastern counterparts, and they were discriminated against. People in East Pakistan were discriminated against. All the plum posts belong to people from West Pakistan, and a lot of atrocities were committed on these people. Pakistan used its own military on its own people, on its citizen itself. A large number of people were killed in East Pakistan. So there were fringe reports that reported that East Pakistan is suffering on the hands of West Pakistan, the government is killing its own people, so on and so forth. There were many news. And Pakistan categorically denied all these allegations. They said that no, it's just an allegation, mischief of India, so on and so forth, as they usually rant. Now, what happened was, there was a guy called Anthony Mascarenhas, a very veteran and a very respected journalist. He was invited to East Pakistan. Okay, when people asked Pakistan that, what are you up to? What are you doing in your eastern part? They said, no, we are not doing anything. And they invited Anthony and they asked him that, you can come here and you can see for yourself. Now, when Mascarenhas went there, he stayed there for a few days and he saw the brutalities that the Pakistani army was committing. You know, people were killed, just anyone could kill, the army could kill anyone and anywhere. So he was really moved by what he saw, and there were 3 to 4 incidences in front of his eyes when civilians were shot in cold blood. They were shot dead in cold blood by the Pakistani army. So he was appalled by seeing everything. He went back and he wrote a long article. And this article was published in Sunday Times. And everyone, the entire world saw it. Here is the article on your screen. Okay. The article, see the date above, June 13, 1971. The title was Genocide. And here Anthony Mascarenhas talked about each and every details, how the army is committing atrocities, how the basic fundamental rights are being violated with impunity by the Pakistani army. So it was like a shock for the entire world, because their worst fears regarding Pakistan was coming true. Moving ahead, what happened was that East Pakistan was separated by West Pakistan by 2000 kilometers. India lied in between. And Western Pakistan consisted of Urdu speaking, as I told you, Muslims, while Eastern Pakistan consisted of Bengali speaking Muslims. The cultural difference, the linguistic difference. Now, language has always been an emotive issue. Even in India, you have seen agitations on the basis of language. In fact, Andhra Pradesh was the first state that was created on linguistic basis. So even today, the Telangana and so on and so forth, even in Russia, you will study this in your world history, even in Russia, the Pan-Slav movement, okay, and after that, in USSR, Russian language has imposed on the entire Soviet Union. That was not liked by everyone. So language has always been an emotive issue. Here also it was an issue, Urdu and Bengali. Again, add to this, there were cultural dissimilarities and the living style also differed. Western Pakistan dominated Eastern part by dominating all their government jobs in almost all sectors. The important and the high positions went to the Western Pakistanis. Now, East Pakistan revolted. Okay, whenever there will be a suppression, people will rise against it. It has happened everywhere in almost all times. So something similar happened in East Pakistan. They revolted and it was brutally crushed by West Pakistan. See, 3 lakh people died. 3 lakh people were killed by Pakistani army. 3 lakh Pakistanis were killed by Pakistani army. Now this is unprecedented, okay? And they called it Operation Searchlight. The entire process of killing 3 lakh people, it was called as Operation Searchlight by the Pakistan. You can see the image on your screen. See how people are being shot in cold blood at point blank. Okay. Just have a look at it. You all can see it, right? So these are the Pakistani soldiers killing the Pakistani citizens in East Pakistan. See, there's a dead body. A guy is trying to save himself over it and he is in front of a rifle. And there's another guy in the backside, you can see, died or about to die. This is what was happening in Operation Searchlight as called by the Pakistani army. Now, what was the option in front of people from East Pakistan? They left their places and they came to India. Bangladesh shares the longest border with India. If you see the map, Bangladesh shares the longest border with India. Try to locate the states with which Bangladesh shares the border. There have been questions in your prelims with regards to map. So please see this and see how many states share border with Bangladesh. So these people started running to West Bengal, Tripura, Bihar, Assam, and almost 10 lakh people infiltrated into these Indian states. Now they became refugees. When such a vast amount, such a large number of people come to your state, of course you have to do something about it. They need a shelter to live. You know, they need food, they need water, they need at least the basic amenities, the bare minimum necessities of life, which has to be provided on humanitarian grounds. But then consider India of that time, okay? Socialist era, poverty, dismal growth rate, not a burgeoning industry, so on and so forth. So India was not in a position to accommodate everyone, and the Prime Minister, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, said that we don't have the place, money or material for all the refugees that are coming from Bangladesh, from East Pakistan, and she was absolutely correct. Now, she called a meeting, a cabinet meeting was called, she was the Prime Minister, she called a cabinet meeting on 25th of April 1971, and General Sam Manekshaw, he was the head of the Indian Army, he also attended that meeting. Now, the states that are mentioned on your on this slide, you see the chief ministers of the state, they wrote to the Prime Minister that we are suffering. The refugees have come to our states and they are putting a burden on our resources. So please do something about it. Indira Gandhi asked the army head, Sam here refers to, here on we will refer, Sam means General Sam Manekshaw, okay. She asked Sam that please do something about it. Okay, it means that she was hinting at a military action. He is the guy. Field Marshal Sam Hormuz Chief Ramji Jamshedji Manekshaw, the full name. He was a Parsi and he was the army chief. And he played a very, you know, important and a very vital part in this war. And what a glorious career he had, a very decorated soldier. We'll know more about him as we proceed. Now, Sam said that we cannot fight right now. And if we fight, this is what he said, if we fight, then, madam, let me assure you that we will be defeated. Why he said so? Because there were reasons. Okay, what were the reasons? That there were not even enough ammunitions and soldiers were not available. It's not like India was running short of soldiers, but the soldiers were scattered in entire India. So they had to be mobilized on the Eastern Pakistan front. And he said that the mobilization would take at least a month. And the armored division had only 13 tanks. What will we do with 13 tanks? Okay. So he the unpreparedness that India was in, he said that we are not at all prepared in order to go for a war. Indira Gandhi told him that we cannot stay aloof, we cannot remain silent, and you have to prepare for the war. Okay, you have to prepare for the war in coming times. And how much time would you take? Sam said, of course, it will take some months. Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, now this guy was leading the protest in East Pakistan. He was the one who was fighting against the autocratic rule of Pakistan in East Pakistan. He was the one leading the people. Now a coup happened in Pakistan. Yahya Khan declared martial law. General Yahya Khan, he declared martial law, and Mujibur Rahman was jailed. Coup means where the army revolts against the government. So Yahya Khan was the general. He became the president after declaring martial law. Something similar to what Pervez Musharraf did. Pakistan has this glorious record. And now let me tell you a more fascinating fact. Pakistan has this glorious record where no democratically elected government has served a full term. Okay. And Mujibur Rahman was jailed. Now, when the elections happened, he swept the parliamentary elections. Mujibur Rahman swept the parliamentary elections. He won. His party was known, still is there. His party, Awami League, won all seats except two seats. They won all seats in Eastern Pakistan. And he became, if the results were valid, he would have been the Prime Minister of Pakistan. Getting such a massive mandate, it was, if the law of the land was to be followed, he would have been the Prime Minister of Pakistan. But Yahya Khan and Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was the Prime Minister, Yahya Khan was the President of Pakistan. They had some other plans. They never wanted that Rahman should become Prime Minister. So he revolted. Now try to understand this. A democratically elected person who has won the election. Now he's denied what should be rightfully his. He revolts. Okay, Rahman revolts and Yahya Khan unleashes force on East Pakistan. Again, the atrocities increase. They send more army into the East Pakistan. They ask everyone, whosoever is against the rule of Pakistan, the Pakistani government should be killed, should be liquidated. Now, earlier 10 lakh people were in India, as you saw in the previous slides. They started running towards India. The refugee influx increased. Indira Gandhi, IG here refers to the Indira Gandhi. On 24th of May 1971, she spoke in the House. House here means she spoke inside the Parliament. And she said this, here is the quote, that the internal problem of Pakistan has now become internal problem of India. Let me explain this quote. Internal problem of Pakistan refers to the civil war going on in East Pakistan. Has now become internal problem of India because people from East Pakistan are taking shelter in India. They have become refugees in India. So this means that they are putting a burden on our resources, on Indian resources. So it's no longer an internal problem of Pakistan. It has now become an internal problem of India. This is what she said. America had its reason to favor Pakistan. See, Pakistan has been a Cold War ally of USA. You will read about, you study in details about Cold War in your World History paper 1 again. Here you will study about Cold War. It is nothing but it refers to a tense situation that prevailed between two bloc leaders, USA and USSR, though no actual war ever occurred between them. Reasons for this Cold War was affiliation to different ideologies. USA followed capitalism, USSR followed communism. Pakistan went with USA. Pakistan was a part of SEATO, SEATO, Southeast Atlantic Treaty Organization. India at that time chose NAM, the Non-Aligned Movement. Okay, so USA favored Pakistan, Pakistan being an ally. And the NSA, the National Security Advisor of USA, was Henry Kissinger. Indira Gandhi asked him to make President Nixon, the American President Nixon, to take action against Pakistan, else she will have to do something. India will intervene militarily. Indian military will intervene in it if USA remains aloof to it. Now, on 9th August 71, Indo-Soviet Friendship Treaty was signed. India signed a 20-year friendship treaty with USSR, and Indira Gandhi was trying to diplomatically encircle Pakistan, and Sam Manekshaw was trying to militarily encircle Pakistan. Okay, Sam said, just recall what we discussed right now. Sam said that I need space, I need some time so that I can prepare for war. Meanwhile, Indira Gandhi will start traveling the world to make favorable opinion for India against Pakistan. Okay, so and when the Soviet treaty with India was signed, it was alleged by the opposition of that time that it's a violation of non-alignment principles. It's a dilution of the credentials of non-aligned movement. On one hand, you say that we are non-aligned, we will not align with any power blocks, and on the other hand, you are signing a friendship treaty. So much so that this word socialist was inserted in the preamble of the Indian Constitution. It was inserted by Indira Gandhi. Two more words were inserted. Go and find out which three words were inserted in the preamble of the Constitution. But that was necessary at that time. The friendship was in favor of India. Now, India started Operation Instruction 52, May 71, 1971, and Sam sent a top secret message to the Eastern Command head at Kolkata. What was that message? The message is that please organize and train people in Eastern Pakistan. Organize people. See, people were already agitated against Pakistan. The East Pakistanis were already waging a war, but they could have never won that war because they were against a trained army. Pakistani army was a trained army, trained in the modern warfare of that time. They had better weapons, okay, everything. They had arms, ammunitions. So Indian army started training the Eastern Pakistanis, okay, whosoever was willing to fight against Pakistan, and they called it Mukti Bahini. Mukti Bahini was the term used for it, for the people who were trained by Indian army to fight the Pakistanis. Man on your screen, okay, Brigadier Sujan Singh, Special Frontier Force. He was overseeing the entire process. It is also known as Operation 22, and he was helped by RAW, Research and Analysis Wing, the Secret Service of India. So see, it was a multi-layered task. Army was involved, intelligence was involved, and some very high-ranking officers of the rank of brigadiers were overseeing everything. And 10 camps were made in September 1971 to train Mukti Bahini cadre. 20,000 people were trained per month by India. Can you imagine? 20,000 Eastern Pakistanis are trained by the Indian Army to fight Pakistan every month. So, as I told you, when Indira Gandhi was diplomatically trying to encircle Pakistan by visiting Europe, by visiting America, by visiting many countries, here was Sam Manekshaw in the Indian Army trying to militarily encircle Pakistan. Indira Gandhi started touring Europe, and she did that for 3 weeks in order to bring Europe with India. Meanwhile, 1 crore refugee came to India. Between March to September, 1 crore people from East Pakistan entered India, and that was putting a burden of ₹3,000 crore on the exchequer. Okay, Indira Gandhi's patience was ending. November 1971, Pakistan Air Force started entering Indian airspace. Okay, see again, they were the one who initiated it here. Yahya Khan, the president, threatened war. And on 3rd of December 1971, Pakistan attacked India. They formally attacked India. If the enemy army enters into your territory, if it violates your LOC, then it's an act of war. Okay, they crossed the LOC and they attacked India. Blackout was declared in Delhi. What do you mean by blackout? All the lights are switched off. During night, all the lights are switched off so that enemy is not able to locate your position. And Indira Gandhi at the time was touring West Bengal. She had to come to Delhi via Lucknow. And she had back-to-back meetings with the military heads, cabinet, and all, even the leader of the opposition. And then she went to the radio, All India Radio, and announced that Pakistan has attacked India, and now the war is on. And by this time, India was ready for it. India was absolutely ready for this war. Now the army started moving towards Dhaka. Okay, and Air Force, see, on one hand, the army is entering Dhaka, that is in Bangladesh, East Pakistan, and here Air Force started bombing the Western Pakistan. Mukti Vahini, which was trained by India, was already fighting the Pakistani forces. Okay, so a trained and prepared Indian army was getting help from Mukti Vahini because they were better aware of the local conditions and everything. So Indian army started conquering fronts one by one in Bangladesh. They started winning comfortably. Now the Battle of Longewala, the much famed Battle of Longewala, yeah, he is the one, Major Kuldeep Singh Chandpuri. Pakistan targeted the western front of India, Longewala. Longewala was the post, and Major Kuldeep Singh Chandpuri, 23rd Punjab Regiment, was guarding this post along with his 83 soldiers. Now there were 84 people, including this Major Kuldeep Singh Chandpuri. Hardly a number when you are in a war. And a tank regiment came from Pakistan under Major Tariq Mir. Okay, a tank regiment was coming from Pakistan at Longewala. And who was standing by to defend India? Chandpuri and his 83 soldiers against the tank regiment. Now there are more than 1,000 soldiers in a tank regiment. They have tanks, they have, you know, all sort of weapons. And here were 83 soldiers with their maybe rifles, MMG, LMG, light machine guns, and medium machine guns. So they were outnumbered. And then what happens? Major Kuldeep asks for reinforcement. He asks for reinforcement. He says that Pakistan tank regiment is coming here. We are just 84 of us are here. So I need reinforcement. But I'll say it's not possible right now. For whatever reasons, it's not possible. And the Air Force could not help at that time. Air Force could not come to the rescue of Indian Army because they were having hunter jets. And these hunter jets were not equipped with night vision. They could not fight during night time. Now, what was the purpose behind Pakistan trying to, you know, move from Longewala? Because they wanted to annex Jaisalmer Air Base. And if they would have succeeded in annexing the Jaisalmer Air Base, they would have got a decisive advantage in the war. Now, Kuldeep Singh Chandpuri was asked that if you want, you can come back. We can do things later on, but he refused and he said that I'm going to stay here. I'm not leaving my post. I and my 83 soldiers will live here. Let the Pakistani tank regiment come. This is what happened. This is a scene from movie Border. Sunny Deol played the role of Kuldeep Singh Chandpuri. And entire night, the 83 soldiers defended India against a massive tank regiment from Pakistan. The role was played by Sunny Deol in movie Border. I have taken this snap from there. In the morning, Air Force comes to the help of India to help the Indian Army, and the entire Pakistani tank regiment was bombed by Indian Air Force. The 83 soldiers who were under Kuldeep Singh Chandpuri were able to hold the entire tank regiment for one night. With the first ray of sun, the Indian Air Force comes and they bomb each and every tank. It was a complete rout once the Air Force of India came. Okay, now on Western Front, Pakistan was getting isolated and Indian Army was taking consistent leads. Indian Army was winning. Now India started what is known as Operation Trident. Okay, all the three organs of Indian military went for an onslaught. Onslaught means a very intense attack against the Pakistan. India used Air Force, India used Army, India used Navy. Admiral Kurubilla, okay, INS Mysore went on the Western Front and they bombed the entire Karachi port. And there was a naval base of Pakistan that was destroyed by INS Mysore, the Indian naval ship Mysore. Now there was INS Vikrant, which was fighting on Western Front, and it had aircraft carrier in it. Which meant that fighter jets can take off from this ship, and they destroyed the Chittagong port. Chittagong again, it's now very famous city in Bangladesh. Earlier, it was a part of East Pakistan. So the aircraft which took off from INS Vikrant destroyed the Chittagong port. Now Pakistan sent a submarine, PNS Ghazi. Now the person who was into the command of Ghazi was a very notorious person. Okay, and Indian Army knew about it. Indian military knew about this guy, and it was sent to destroy INS Vikrant. Now try to understand this: a submarine destroying a warship like INS Vikrant. It would have been, it would have lowered the morale of Indian forces. But then INS Rajput came and it destroyed PNS Ghazi before it could do anything against INS Vikrant. Again, a movie came, maybe a year or two, Ghazi. Regarding this very incident where this submarine was sent by Pakistan to destroy the INS Vikrant, but it was destroyed by INS Rajput itself. Indira Gandhi announced in Parliament that India has decided to recognize the Republic of Bangladesh. Now this was big. It means that we are legitimizing Bangladesh. We are recognizing Bangladesh, which means that Pakistan no longer operates in that part. It is now an independent country known as Bangladesh. And America was favoring Pakistan, as I told you, and they wanted a ceasefire. Now this ceasefire was vetoed by USSR. USSR was standing by the side of India. Vetoed means if one P5, the permanent five in UNO, has this veto power, when if one says no, it becomes no. So USSR vetoed it. Now Pakistan asked for help. Now that ceasefire cannot be done. Ceasefire has been vetoed by Soviet Union, but America can always help Pakistan. So when they asked for help, President Nixon sent its most powerful 7th USA naval fleet toward Indian Ocean to stop India. Now India had no chance against USA. I mean, USA military was superior to that of India at that time. And when the 7th naval fleet came to stop India and to help Pakistan, India knew about this, that something like this is happening. And Indira Gandhi asked Sam at that time that the 7th Naval Fleet is coming. Sam was like, okay, I'll complete the work before the 7th Fleet came, and this actually happened. Now, in the meanwhile, just try to recall that treaty, this 1971 treaty between India and Soviet Union, the 20-year friendship treaty. USSR also moved its 10th operative battle group. Again, it was a ship, the 10th operative battle group, from Pacific Ocean to Indian Ocean under Admiral Vladimir Krugliakov. Now, it was equipped with nuclear submarines. Now, American warship is coming to defend Pakistan, and the Soviet Union warship is coming to make sure that American warship does not cause harm to any of the military assets of India. When you will study about Cold War, you will read about some incidences that almost led to Third World War. And you will come across something, an event which is termed as Cuban Missile Crisis. You have to study these things. Cuban Missile Crisis, it was said that it was the closest when USSR and USA went for a direct confrontation. This was also close. This war would not have remained a war between India and Pakistan, but between USA and USSR. By 12 December, the war was about to turn global. And Sam Manekshaw warned Pakistani army to surrender. Now, the person who was holding the command, Lieutenant General A.A.K. Niazi, the Pakistani army, he refused to surrender, and he said that I'll fight till the last man I have, the last man and the last bullet. I will fight. I will not surrender. And they were desperately looking for American help. Now, Indian troops surrounded Dhaka and targeted the Pakistani governor house. Now, after this, the governor house was targeted by Indian army in Dhaka, Niazi broke down and he agreed for ceasefire. So, Sam said ceasefire is going to happen if you surrender. Lieutenant General Jagjit Singh Arora, he was the commanding chief at Western Front where the war was taking place. And he sent Major General J.F.R. Jacob. Major General Jacob passed away, I guess, 2 to 3 years back. He sent Major General J.F.R. Jacob to Dhaka to prepare for Pakistan's surrender. Now, something very interesting happened here. Jacob, Niazi, Tika Khan was boss of Niazi. They all were students in the same college. Okay, when partition happened, the one who decided to stay with India stayed here, and the one who wanted Pakistan went there. So Tika Khan, Niazi all went to Pakistan, and these guys, Jacob, Jagjit Singh Arora, they stayed in India, but they knew each other since their college days. So when Jacob went there, I have not mentioned it here, I'll just narrate it to you. When Jacob went there, he asked that, so the war will end now? And Niazi said, yes, there will be a ceasefire under UN observation. Jacob said, no, you are going to surrender. So Niazi said, are you all right? Are you mad? I will surrender, you think so? He said, yes, you will surrender because you don't have an option. Niazi got angry and said, before I kill you, just escape from here. Run away. I will kill all Indians and so on and so forth. Jacob said, please try to introspect. You can fight for 10 days. And what will happen on the 11th day? The Americans are not coming to help you. No supply is coming from West Pakistan. We have cut the supply lines. Mukti Bahini has been trained by us. And remember all the atrocities that you have committed on Mukti Bahini. They will do the same thing with you. On 11th day, you can just fight for 10 days. This is the army. These are the numbers that you have. These many people are with you. This is the ammunition that you are left with. These are the grenades that you have. These are the bullets that you have. Indian army had each and every information because Mukti Bahini was constantly updating them. So Niazi could see that, yes, this guy is talking sense. I can't fight for more than 10 days. And on 11th day, Indian army plus Mukti Bahini. That would be too much to handle. So finally he said, okay, I'll surrender. but please make it a closed ceremony. Jacob said, no, it will be a public surrender. You will give guard of honor to Indian Army. And this actually happened. Look at this iconic image. Here is Niazi surrendering to Jagjit Singh Arora. Look at the second image. Look at Niazi's face and look at Arora's face. The same Niazi who vote to kill each and every Indian. Okay, so here is what happened. Niazi surrendered. In fact, 90,000 of Pakistanis surrendered. Total 90,000 Pakistani soldiers surrendered. And India, according to, followed the Geneva Convention. And they were treated as prisoners of wars. Eventually, they were returned to Pakistan. No harm was done to them. This was the presentation that I had today. Whatever questions you have,